this morning is taken from Acts of the Apostles, chapter 1, from verses 6 to 8. And it says, when the apostles met together with Jesus, they asked him, Lord, will you at this time give the kingdom back to Israel? Jesus said to them, the times and the occasions are set by my Father's own authority, and it is not for you to know when they will be. But when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, you will be filled with power, and you will be witnesses for me in Jerusalem, in all Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. Amen. But today he says, you shall be my witnesses. You shall be my what? Who will be witnesses? Who? How many of us are ready to be witnesses for Jesus? Are you sure? If you are sure, stand up and make a noise. It's just like somebody who is a poor man and he wants to build two-story building. Can he do this? He needs financial work, power and muscle in order to do that. So for you to witness for Jesus, you need power. And this power has been categorized into four or even five of them. The first one of them is what is called the dunamis power. Then the other one is called kratos. And then the other one is known as power, power from God. And then the other one is exousia, and the other one is issues. These are the powers that are conferred upon us by the Holy Spirit. Like Paul, talking about it in Ephesians chapter 1, verse 19 to 21, he says, I pray that the eyes of your hearts may be enlightened in order that you may know the hope to which he has called you, the riches of his glorious inheritance in his holy people, and his incomparable great power. Incomparable what? Great power. Qualified. Incomparable great power for us who believe that power, if that power is the same as the mighty strength he exerted when he raised Christ from the dead and seated him at his right hand in heavenly realms, far above all rules and authorities, power and dominion, and every name that is involved, not only in the present age, but also in the one to do what? Come. So, the power that we are talking about here is power that is not comparable to any power. That's what we are talking about. And then when you talk about dunamis, dunamis has to do with ability, power or ability to walk. But this power and ability is inherent. When you say that something is inherent, it's inside of you. So, but it might not work, it might reside there, it might be affect you. It might be inside of you in an inaction way. And so, for it to become useful, then it must be put into action. Praise the Lord. I don't know if you're understanding what I'm saying. I don't know what you used to talk about it now. Like, somebody has an image, but he doesn't know that he has that image. You are, the thing is inside of you, but it's not in words expressed. Okay, I think I will have a good example of it when I get to that point. So, he says it resides inside of us. It can also be the ability to achieve and the potential for functioning in some way. Then, it says that tying all the meaning together, dunamis means vested and inherent power of God in all of us. All of us have the power of God in us. Do you believe that? And for some of us, we don't know. So we are given a power that is incomparable and great. In other words, all of us are given extraordinary and what is called homogonous power and strength from God. Something that is huge, bigger than anything you can think of. There is nothing that is compared to it. And then it says it's like a dynamite, which, by the way, originates from dunamis, which means the power that comes from God, and that we hold an explosive power of God in us. Praise the Lord. See, if we realize sometimes who we are, we will not be afraid. Certain things will not happen to us. When they use dynamite, they use dynamite to break rocks. When they throw it, it will shatter the rock into pieces. So we are like that. That is the kind of power God has deposited in each and every one of us. It's not limited to one particular person. That's why the Lord says, when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, you will receive what? You will receive what? Ike. Ike is a bar. And when you act, it will be explosive, that nobody will stand on your way. Then the other one that talks about kratos is a Greek word, kratos. It says action power. I think this thing they say action beta. Action what? Beta. Action power. Now, that power that is inside of you is elicited and then it explodes. It says mighty strength. The ability to exhibit or express resistant strength or might. Why dunamis lies inside of us and may not be really visible, kratos, in the exhibition or expression of being of that power through a firm visible dominion. You now assert yourself and bully. So God exerted that kind of power, was the power that brought about the resurrection of Jesus. God had the power. When the time came, kratos took over. He implemented it kratosically by moving the stone away. In Mark's Gospel chapter 16, when Mary and the rest of the women were going to the tomb early in the morning to anoint the body of Jesus, their first concern was, you remember what they said? What did they say? Rolled away even before they arrived. Even before they did what? Before you arrive, the stone will be rolled away. And I tell you, I think the day before yesterday, I tell you that I saw a door in the spiritual and God opened the door. And many of us have driven out with force. He had already opened the door by the chaos power of what? Of God. So that by your arrival, that thing that seems difficult is already taken care of. Because like the psalmist will say in Psalm 121, he said, I look to the hills and the mountains, from where shall my help come from? And he said, my help shall come from who? The Lord who did what? Made heaven and what? Earth. The God who said, you will receive
of what? River states.
When you see him, you see money. Money speaking, because it's carrying the money of what? River state. So he says, this power, when you talk about exousia, is the bearer of power, authority, government is laid upon his shoulders. So when he appears, everybody does what? Bows. So the power he's going to give will make you a bearer of authority. That's why the Lord says in the morning, the Father, he said to his disciples, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to what? I therefore commission you to go out. What did he commission? He transferred what? Authority. And with that authority, they moved out. And when they moved out, what did they do? They were doing exactly what the Lord was what? Doing. Did they raise the dead? Huh? Did they raise dead people? Did they cure sick people? Did they preach the word of God? Places that were difficult to break, were they able to penetrate? Even with the persecution, were they also making inroads? Nothing could do what? Stop them, because as they were going, they were bearing power. So it's like a bulldozer carrying what? No matter how it is, the bulldozer will come and it will keep on what? Pushing. Even when it is hard and it will do like this, it will keep on doing what? Pushing. When it pushes the family and the family will do like this and do like this, it will go back and do it. When it hits the stop line, it will do what? The power will, the pattern will fall. So in that sense, that exousia is that you become a bearer of power. And that power is official. It's an official power that is given to government authorities. Obasanjo, if Obasanjo comes here now, maybe he might come with two cars and one or two policemen. Is it not so? Eh? Nobody will sing national anthem for him. Is it not so? But if Buhari appears here, whether he's doing well or not doing well, national anthem will go off. And everybody will stand at attention. If you make careless movement, they will shoot you down. Because the power that that man is wearing cannot be toyed with. Anywhere he goes, Nigeria is there. And so, the power is enormous. And so it says, in Christian context and faith, exousia would mean God's priest. God's priest. God's head. With Christ. And the other day I talked about it. And ambassadors of Christ. Which is we are. With which we are according to the scriptures. So right now, when that power is in you, inside of you, you are no more yourself. Say it to yourself, I'm no more myself. I am an ambassador for Christ. Feel that first thing that says, you have become a chosen world, race, a royal world, priesthood, a people set apart for God. So that is what the power does. The power sets you apart for God. You become Christ-like. You become Christ's priest, co-heirs in the power and authority that the Lord wields. Sometimes it is my imagination that we don't know who we are. That's why we are having too many troubles in our world and around us. If we know the kind of what the Lord, the enormity of what God has given to us, many of us will struggle to get it. And when we get it, a lot of things will happen around us. Amen. 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 Now, there is this comparison that is made about this power. I know Mr. Boniface will certainly know what I'm talking about. There is a car, a race car, that is known as Lamborghini Aventador. That car, it says, it has 1,600 horsepower. And it says, it's the, in the world, it's the highest horsepower car you can ever think of. it's an engine. And then it says that you can have that car or you have that engine with you, but you can never know the power of it until you put it on the road for tests. It is only on the road you discover the strength of that engine. And then that engine, for it to bring out the best of its power, then there are certain things that are needed. One is the discipline that you must check the engine, check the oil, check the water, maintain the car, clean it up, follow the manual of the producer, and then put it for race. Nobody will see your back. And I pray that your engine will be activated by the Holy Spirit so that nobody will see your back in the name of Jesus. When you do not activate the engine, then you will remain stagnant. Your car can never move. And nobody will be able to evaluate the power of the engine that you have. That is how some of us are. Some of us are dormant. Some of us are lukewarm. That's why Paul said, fight into play the power you have received from the Holy Spirit. We are not fighting into play. And that is why the church has put this period for us. That we might find into flaming embers the power that resides in you. And what do you do? How do you do that? By discipline. And what is discipline? Jesus said, stay in the upper room. Stay. Some of us have been coming here for the last, today is the seventh day. Sorry, eighth day, I mean. We've been coming here for the last 8 days. And you think it's a joke. There is something God is doing in your life. There is a new awareness He has created in you. There is a new infusion of exousia, of dynamis, of kratos, of core power that He has put inside of you. That is supposed to be a force that lifts you to a different position and you begin to operate at a different wavelength. And so for all that to happen, my dear friends, so that the power of the lumbagi that is inherent in us will move us to action. And when it moves us to action, then we are supposed to do something with the Lord. And then also for that to happen, there must be a constant practice of avoiding corruption by sin. Because it is sin that defies us and makes it difficult for us to be alive and be on fire. And then there must be the infilling of the Holy Spirit upon us, so that when that Holy Spirit comes upon you, then certain things will begin to happen around you. And so, my dear friends, as we do all that, we pray that the exousia of God will envelop us in the name of Jesus. Now, what do you need this power for? And what is this power for? What will this power do for you? This power will put you on track. This power will exacerbate certain courage in you. This power will embolden you. We have people fail, we have this seem difficult, you'll be able to penetrate. This power is the power that raised Jesus from the dead. This power is the power that God used to bring about transformation of things. That was the power that moved Peter to give a confession on the day of Pentecost to witness. You need this power to witness for God. And then when we get it, then we begin to function for Him. It will bring you opposition, it will bring you challenges, there will be difficulties, but you need that power. Without the power, we cannot function. That's why many of us Catholics are dead in spirit and in action. We hear and hear, but we cannot implement. The implementation of the injunction of Jesus can only come about when there is that power inside of you. Praise the Lord. Amen. What if we stop here now, or at the end of this night, and say, okay, today, Friday, I know many people want to go to business, but today we're not going for business. We are going to go into the street to preach the word of God. Will you go? Yeah. Yeah? Evangelism.
Yes.
Even Mr. Evan, will you go with us? Today I will say, everybody, lock shop. We are going for, okay, 30 minutes.
said, what is happening here? These men are drunk. You are not drunk,
but you are being intoxicated by the power of the word, Holy Spirit. And then they began to bulldoze their way into various places. Amen. 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 So, the power qualifies you to be a witness. And I want you to say, I want to be a witness for Jesus. I want to be a witness for Jesus. No matter how difficult it will be, I'll be a witness for Jesus. May that your confession be acceptable to God in the name of Jesus. In the book of Esther, the Israelites' lives were on the line. And then the king was made to make a pronouncement against the Jews who were in the lands. Esther had found her way into the king's house. In fact, she became the next queen. When the first queen was deposed because of her misbehavior towards the king, disrespect. And then this Jewish girl who was carried into exile into the land was prepared by the uncle Mordecai, and she became the queen. She rose from nobody to somebody and was lived in the palace. Following from the edict that was passed that the Israelites were going to be exterminated at a particular point in time, the uncle Mordecai who had brought her up came to her and said, this is the time for you to witness. And she said, just like the Lord said, when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, you'll be my what? You'll be my what? But Esther was afraid. She could not do it. And then Mordecai said to her, if you do not do it, one way or the other, help will come to the Jews from someone else. But your family will go down in history. You also will go down in history. And with that statement, she was spurred into action. Then she said, go and compose a meeting of prayer. That like we're doing a meeting of prayer for me, so that I also will go into prayer. She went into prayer, and at the end of that prayer, she received an enormous energy and power to go to the king. And when she appeared before the king, even in the presence of the man who had inspired the king to make this pronunciation in the presence of Haman, what did the king do? The king granted all her requests, all her love requests, because the power of exousia, the power of dunamis, the power of kratos, and the power of kucha and ischio were all resident in her. And when she moved out, the king could not stand her power and her presence. So will also men not stand you when you come out with the power of the Lord inside of you, in the name of Jesus. She, her strategy was the strategy of prayer and fasting and building relationship. Prayer, fasting, and what? Building relationship. With that, she moved out. Another person who witnessed for God when he had the power was Nehemiah. Nehemiah was moved by the ugly story about the city of Jerusalem, how everything had crumbled. And so, while in exile, he went to the king. But before he went to the king, he made a confession and said, God, our people have sinned against you. They have looked away from the blessings that you have given to them. He made a confession. He was heartbroken and he confessed, and God accepted his confession. And then at the end of the day, he said, God, grant me this one opportunity that I will have a privilege to rebuild the city. And God granted him the opportunity by making him have a one-to-one encounter with the king. And he presented to the king, I do not want to be a cupbearer again in your kingdom. I want you to give me the lead to go back and rebuild the city of God in Jerusalem. And the king said, is that all you need? And he said, yes. And the king said, I grant you that.
And not just granting you that, I will supply all the materials and all the money, all the workmen you need to rebuild the city. And so he left and went back and rebuilt the city of God, because there was that power of God. The Holy Spirit, the Spirit of God overtook him. And when the Spirit of God took over him, every word that came from his mouth was accepted by the king. Child of God, someone may have said no to you, but by the Spirit of the Lord, the person will say yes to you. Situations may have said no to you, but by the Spirit of the Lord, they will say yes to you. You will become an advocate for God's blessing for your family in the name of Jesus. You will become a deliverer for your people in the name of Jesus. Moses was a witness for the power of God. Moses was raised in the palace, but circumstances took him away from the palace. He became a fugitive in the desert. There in the desert, he met God. There in the desert, he prayed. There in the desert, he was overtaken by the power of God. And that power moved him. When God said, Moses, you will go back to Egypt, he said, no, I'm a stammerer. When he said, no, I will not go there because Pharaoh will kill me, because I killed someone. God said, you will go. He said, God, can you choose another person? He brought me in chapter 4, verse 13 of Exodus. He said, God, no, I am not qualified to go. Choose another person. God said, you will go. My power will be with you. And God used it. When he finally had no choice, he had to go. And when he witnessed before Pharaoh, he said to Pharaoh, I am a servant of the God of the Jews. His name is I Am That I Am. His name is I Am That I Am What I Am. His name is Yahweh Elyon. His name is El Shaddai. His name is the Ancient of Days. He has sent me to you to witness and to tell you, let my people go. Amen. And Pharaoh said, who is that God that has sent you? I don't know that God, and I don't want to know about him. And then he said, I've finished telling him. And he left. And God began to deal with him one stage to the other until the tenth plague. Then his eyes opened, and he let the children of Israel what? Go. When the power comes upon you, you will not know how it will happen. When the power is with you, it will not be about you to bring about his workability. It is God that will bring about the workability of that circumstance for you. Because for Moses, all he needed to do was to pronounce, say it. But how it happened? Pharaoh's heart was hardened. Pharaoh did not want to oblige. But eventually, God made him, God subdued him, God brought him to his knees, and he said, carry your people, go and worship your God. And in fact, go, pray, and bring blessing back to me, so that I that action. To prepare him, he took
go to Galatians chapter 1, follow him. He took him to Arabia, where he stayed for 3 years in preparation for the mission. And finally, he brought him back. And when he brought him back, Paul began to do what? Witness. He began to witness. In Acts of the Apostles chapter 19, when he went to Ephesus, he witnessed for Jesus. He asked the people, have you received the Holy Spirit? They said, we have not even had anything like the Holy Spirit. He said, then what kind of baptism do you have? He said, baptism of John. And he said, okay. He prayed for them and baptized them in the name of Jesus, Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, and then laid his hands upon them, and what? Power came. They received the Holy Spirit. He witnessed them. And then Paul went further. If you go to the book of Philemon, his letter to Philemon, he wrote to Philemon and said, take back Onesimus, who used to be your slave, but now my brother and my son, speak, men will do what? They will listen. And I pray for you today. As you speak, let it not be you speaking. Moses spoke, it was not him speaking, but God speaking through him. As you make declarations over your family, may God, may heaven honor your declaration in the name of Jesus. As you make declarations over your situation, may heaven honor it in the name of Jesus. Jesus. May the honor that God has put upon you shine out in the name of Jesus. My dear friends, so many people witness for God. In Luke's Gospel chapter 18, the widow who had gone to the ruler, she demanded for justice, and the man denied her justice. She kept them present, but because the power of God was in him, was in her, she got justice. The king said, I am only a man. If I do not give this woman what she deserves, she will worry me to death. Anybody holding your thing, may you release it in the name of Jesus. Anybody standing on your way, may that person get away from you in the name of Jesus. Anyone who has said no to your request, may the Spirit of God that resides in you make that person to listen to you unconditionally in the name of Jesus. May your request be granted. May your blessing be released. Even those who are owing you in business, you may make an effort for them to pay you. When they hear your voice this time, may God, through you, speak to their hearts to release that money in the name of Jesus. That office that you have applied and they have been turning down your paper, may they remember your paper this season in the name of Jesus. And they will call you back in the name of Jesus. The last thing I will say, another person that witnessed when he had the power, there are so many of them. The prophet Nathan to David in 2 Samuel chapter 11, chapter 12. Samuel was sent by God to David. Say, when that power is on you, you will be on fire. You will be on what? You will speak the truth unconditionally. That is the problem with some of us. When that fire comes, you have to speak it out the way it is. Whether somebody is hot, and that's why some people will hate you. Some for them, you should even die. Nathan went to David and he began with the story. See, there was this man who went, who had a little goat or whatever, and he trained it. And at the end, somebody came to collect it when he had a visitor and killed it and took it away from him. But this man had plenty in his house. And when he finished listening to that, he said, that person deserves the world. And Nathan told him, you are the person.
David said, "Hey, boy, for the power." And he told him.
But that witnessing of Nathan to David bore fruit. Fruit of repentance on the part of David. David sought the Lord. And again, that witnessing of his put an end to further punishment and suffering in the land of Israel, because David did what? Repented. That's why God says, when you receive power, you will receive power. And what did Jesus say? I think in John's Gospel, chapter 15 and chapter 16, he says, when the Holy Spirit comes, he will convict you of what? Sin. He will convict you of what? Sin. You will not know when you have offended God. We pray that that power will come upon us in the name of Jesus. We pray that that power will elicit authority, will embolden us, and give us the courage to witness for Jesus. That we become dispensers of God's love wherever we are. That your marketplace will become an altar for you to witness for God in the name of Jesus. And your house will become an altar for you to witness for Jesus in the name of Jesus. Do you agree to that? Stand up. You know who you are. I know who I am. You know who you are. You know who you are. Aisha, you need to tell God who you are. Who you are. You are supposed to be a learning power, an explosive power. You realize the power of the engine you are carrying. You're supposed to be untouchable. For people, men and women have led us because we do not know who we are. Because many of us do not know the power that resides in us, the authority that you have, that power, that explosive power in you. You do not know it. They will make me to know your power. Make me to know who I am. The strength that you have given to me. Thank God, I want to know the power. I want to recover my power. I want to recover my power. Tell me, you want to recover your power. You need that power to operate. You need that power to dismantle. The Lord says, in the promise, he says, you will receive power. Power of resurrection. Power of healing. Power of making declarations. And when you make those declarations, they will come to pass. Because they reside in you. In the last few days, we'll be preparing ourselves for that power. For the reception of that power. Lift up your hand and say, that power, I need you now. Of your hands. Tell the Holy Spirit, take over me. Take over. The power to witness. I call you from the four ends of the earth now. For these men and women who have been in obedience to the direction of God, they do not miss power. They capture power. They of God, the core of God, from the four ends of the earth, arise, arise and locate your people, because with you, they will be able to witness, but without you, they will be cowards, cowards. You did not create them to be men and women who cry and weep. You made them to be firebrand children of God. When you came upon the disciples on that day, they broke the door. They opened the door and out they went and began